Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. But if you talk books, you also really want to also talk about films. Well, my guest today, Marilyn Ann Moss, has really made a career of writing biographies of famous, really well-known directors. This book is Raoul Walsh, The True Adventures of Hollywood's Legendary Director. So when you see, oh, They Drive by Night or something with Jimmy Cagney on one of those old film channels, you'll know more if you've read this book. It's published by the University of Kentucky, and welcome, Marilyn.
Thank you.
Raoul Walsh was quite a character.
He had as colorful a life off screen as the films he made on screen.
Born in New York, and at age 15 has a nightmare or a dream about Hollywood or coming here.
Well, he has a dream that's almost a nightmare, that is part a nightmare, because he dreams that his mother is dying.
Yeah.
And the truth is she did die right after the dream, which is important in terms of his career, because he felt very sad. He was devastated by the loss of his mother, who used to tell him all kinds of stories of Americana, you know. And so he felt, as he said in his own autobiography back in 1974, that he felt like a half a person after she died. And he then decided that he'd have to fill up that other half with adventures, which is what he set out to do.
Who gave him his first break within films?
The Pathé boys, as he called them, the brothers Frere, the Pathé Frere, who spoke terrible English.
Yep. Yes.
And then he went, the real break came with Griffith.
Yeah.
They kind of pirated him away from Pathé, and he began with Griffith very early.
Was this in France or New York?
No, this was in New York, in New Jersey.
But the Pathé brothers were...
Well, they had a studio in New Jersey.
Uh-huh.
Although we do think that Walsh might have mixed that up with another set of brothers, but he did make Pathé films, so we know he was with them.
Yeah.
And it most likely is New York.
So who then bring, these were the era of 20-minute, 10-minute silent films.
Yes.
Mary Pickford.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She was part of the group with Griffith. She left before they made the move to California.
Yeah.
Which is when Walsh became more active with Griffith.
When he became active, was he also acting with them?
He began as an actor,
mm-hmm.
and Griffith asked him to be an assistant. He had several assistant directors,
yeah.
and Walsh was in charge of the huge scenes. If you look at the mob scenes or the scenes of the Ku Klux Klan on Birth of a Nation, in Birth of a Nation, you see Walsh directing some of those scenes.
Yeah. You can see his touch already.
Yes.
Yeah. Comes to California, and of course, he did become known as the star director at Warner Brothers.
Yes.
But prior to that?
Prior to that, that took a while. That wasn't until 1939. So he came out here about 1913.
Yeah.
And he was with Griffith, and right away, Fox stole him away when William Fox started his studios, and then he went back to New York, and he was working for Fox, where he really made a name for himself. He directed what is still considered to be the very first crime gangster film, feature length, which was Regeneration in 1915.
Definitely a silent film.
Yeah.
Who wrote that?
That was written, oh, the name of the author escapes me, but it was an actual autobiography. And it was called My Mammy Rose. And I actually have the first edition. And it was the story of a boy who is a hoodlum, grows up as a hoodlum, and then meets a woman, falls in love with her, and she's kind of a social worker. And that was Anna Quinlan who was in that.
Mm-hmm.
And he then straightens out. And it was a wonderful actor named Rockwell Fellows.
Yeah.
And it's a beautiful, beautiful film. And you see, as some of the critics even said then, that he had already surpassed Griffith.
Yeah.
In his ability to place the camera.
At that period, what were they paying directors?
Not a lot.
Yeah.
Not a lot, but it very quickly they became very well paid, and they became also kind of media stars.
Mm-hmm.
Very early on, the stars at the directors at Fox, they were seen almost as movie stars. You know,
yeah.
They were this new breed.
Yeah.
And Walsh, having been blessed with good looks,
yeah,
as you can see in this photo here,
decided
early on that he was going to create a persona for himself that was very flamboyant.
Yeah.
And he continued that the rest of his life.
I'm going to jump a little bit, but mm-hmm. What was his position when the Directors Guild wanted to form a union, in a sense?
He was right there.
He was
right there, but then he became inactive in the Directors Guild.
Mm-hmm.
But he was part of the formation of the of OMPUS, of the Academy. He
mm-hmm.
was the formation involved in that. But Walsh was never very
political.
Yeah. Yeah, he was rather conservative in his voting, but not culturally conservative, you know.
Yeah. Growing up out here, I mean, because in a sense he did, he was so young when he came, he got married out here?
He actually, he and his first wife, Miriam Cooper, who was an ingenue, who was actually in the Griffith Company and who was in Regeneration, she was the dark-haired beauty,
yeah.
Whereas Lillian Gish was the light-haired beauty. They got married after Walsh had already left
Griffith?
to go to Fox. She was still with Griffith, so they got married actually in the Southwest. They didn't let Griffith know they were getting married. He wouldn't have liked that.
Yeah.
He liked especially to work with actresses who were fatherless.
Oh, really?
Who he could be a father to.
Uh-huh.
But here's Miriam, who was a lot more histrionic than Walsh ever was. The marriage lasted about 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
But she and he would move back and forth from the West Coast to the East Coast.
Yeah.
And they actually didn't stay anywhere until late in their marriage.
Yeah. She was followed by who? Lorraine?
A woman named Lorraine. And Lorraine was actually a friend of Miriam, who, after Miriam and Walsh adopted two little boys, found Walsh and Aunt Lorraine in the bedroom.
Oh.
So Miriam filed for divorce, but that was a relationship, the relationship in the courts that lasted probably through the late 40s.
Oh, really?
Because he was not very good about paying the money that he owed her for alimony, because he didn't really think he should.
Yeah, when talkies came in, what was his first breakthrough there?
I would say, well, you know, the famous story is how he lost his eye, which has to do with the talkies. And he was slated to star in and direct the very first outdoor talkie, which was in old Arizona,
mm-hmm.
based on the Cisco Kid. And what happened was he was driving a Jeep one night, and he hit a rabbit. And the rabbit's body went through the windshield and landed in the back seat. But Walsh lost his eye because the glass, you know, splattered everywhere and splintered. And so he couldn't star in it. He couldn't even direct it. So it was taken over by Irving Cummings.
Mm-hmm.
And Warner Baxter starred and won an Oscar. So it was slated to be his first outdoor talkie, but it turns out that his first outdoor talkie was a massive, epic attempt called The Big Trail.
Yeah.
And that was the movie where he discovered John Wayne.
Yeah. Marion, what was his name?
Morrison, something
yes.
like that.
Yeah.
And right away he said, "Who's that good-looking fellow?" Because at that point, even though he had been in some mob scenes or group scenes in some John Ford movies, he had never really starred in front of the camera.
What's interesting is how, with one eye, he was able to focus and get the camera's position that it would work.
And what's even more fascinating is that he was doing deep focus already.
Yeah.
And this is only 1930.
And I'm holding up.
Mm-hmm. You're holding up a little later period. At the bottom, the group photo is after Walsh became friends with William Randolph Hearst. These are some of the parties that Hearst and his lover, who became a good friend of Walsh, Marion Davies, had at their house, or one of their many houses, or one of the many houses he had for her. And they became very close friends. They became a foursome. But what is, to go back to the big trail again, it was not only filmed in 35 millimeter, it was also filmed in a process called grandeur, which is to us like 70 millimeter.
Uh-huh.
You know, and so they had to film everything at least four or five times because it was filmed in various languages. So, and then they had everything they did in 35 millimeter, they had to redo and place the actors further apart for the 70 millimeter, which Fox promised it would show and then reneged on.
Who owns the print of that now?
The print is owned by Fox, mm-hmm. still. The 70 no longer exists, but the 35 does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In writing the book, how many of his films were you seeing?
Oh, gosh. What's really sad is how many are gone, are lost. So as you'd imagine, there aren't too many silent films left. I was able to see, actually only recently, The Monkey Talks, 1927. Regeneration mm-hmm. was restored to a point where it's now on DVD. It's a beautiful film. The Big Trail has been restored as best as it can be for DVD. And so, I mean, most of the, a lot of the 30s films are not around.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened was after The Big Trail failed at the box office, it put John Wayne back in the B pictures for about 10 years until, as they say, Ford rescued him for Stagecoach. But Walsh was also doing work wherever he could get it and doing independent work during the 30s.
Yeah. When did he meet up with the Colonel?
The Colonel.
Jack Warner.
1939, he did his first film for Warner Brothers.
Which was?
What a splash that was, The Roaring Twenties.
And then from there?
From there he went on, and he actually went to Republic and made a film with John Wayne again called The Dark Command.
Yeah.
So many films with Walsh. If it wasn't looking at me, I had a hard time remembering things. Dark Command with Walter Pidgeon, who became his brother-in-law, actually.
Yeah.
Because he was married to Lorraine's sister.
He loved horses.
Loved horses, used to breed them, used to bet on them, started Hollywood Park with Eddie Cantor. I think Al Jolson was in on that and Warner was in on that. So he started out at Warner Brothers in 39 and he had a brilliant career there for almost 30 years.
Yeah. What did he consider his finest film?
His favorite film, he would consider The Strawberry Blonde.
Uh-huh.
Because it reminded him of his childhood.
And, of course, The Lost Wife, Blonde.
Strawberry Blonde, that's right. Gee, that's very interesting. What would he consider...